welcome to Room for Discussion. Today we have with us the Director of the Inclusive Green Growth Department at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs here in the Netherlands. Apart from the Ministry's portfolio in foreign policy on food, water and climate security, Mr. René van Hell is also the Ambassador of to the Arctic.
Welcome.
Thank you.
We have a little part of an introduction for you as well, if that's okay.
So the Arctic is not just the North Pole, it's also a vast open ocean, 15 million square kilometers of ice, and the territories of 8 Arctic states. So today we're going to be asking about the cooperation of those 8 Arctic states as they try to combat climate change and your involvement in that, as well as the new economic opportunities to be found in the melting ice, and also the looming threat of militarization. So welcome.
So please give a warm welcome to Mr. Ambassador René van Hell. You can sit here. Welcome.
Welcome. Thank you. Thank you.
So I think we will start off today with a question a lot of the audience is probably wondering. Why do we have a Dutch ambassador to the Arctic?
we're not really an Arctic country, but indeed there are so many things going on, and I think it sort of dates back to the times where there was this Dutch explorer in the 16th century, Barents, who tried to find a passage, Northeast Passage, and ever since we've had sort of a link with the Arctic. But I also think it's because of the proximity. The Arctic is so close to the Netherlands, so and we have interest there, so that's why we have an ambassador. Because whenever you have an ambassador, there's always something that has to do with politics, with economics, with military stuff, and interests.
Yeah, and just to be clear, you're not the ambassador to like polar bears, you're the ambassador to the Arctic Council, right? So is the Arctic Council?
The Arctic Council is an international organization that has 8 members, 8 countries, because the Arctic countries themselves, and observers. And the Netherlands, with Poland and the UK and Germany, has been one of the first observers to that council.
And are indigenous populations also?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. The whole Arctic Council also started with this idea that it was very important to involve the local and the indigenous people. So there are 6 organizations of indigenous people, and they are permanent partners of the Arctic Council.
So I'm from Norway, and I'm quite aware.
Yeah, I already wondered why you picked up this subject, but
exactly.
It's you.
Exactly, and I was super surprised to hear that our Arctic territory was actually discovered by the Dutch over 400 years ago. So as you said, the Dutch may not be as big of a polar nation, but you do have a polar strategy.
Yeah.
Could you perhaps enlighten us what the main aims of the Netherlands are in the Arctic Council currently?
Yeah, it always starts with your own interest, of course. And I think the Netherlands being so vulnerable to climate change, I think that is sort of the starting point from which we are working now. But you rightly pointed out that indeed 400 years ago, there was this explorer who found Svalberg, Spitsbergen. And ever since, we have some kind of presence in things that we no longer doing, like whaling. And we had a coal business there till 1932, until we sold that to the Russians. So there has always been that. But so it has always been initially for especially trading, so to find this Northeast Passage. But now increasingly it's the climate, and it's also sort of the geopolitical things. What, because it is kind of interesting, because if it's true that the North Pole is melting, and there is scientific sort of consensus that somewhere between 2030 and 2050 there will be this free passageway, it also means that something is happening to the border of Russia, which of course also brings it to the fore, like how are they going to respond to that, what is that doing with their perception of security, etc. Of course the same also goes for Canada and the northern part of Canada, by the way.
So what would you say are the main priorities for the Netherlands to achieve in the Arctic Council?
The main priority is to make sure that there is that it stays as intact and as pure as possible, and if there are activities that they do not have a lasting effect, so it's not only do not harm, but also do it in a sustainable manner and make sure that whatever you do there doesn't have a lasting effect. And of course that is not always easy. That's a very lofty goal, but that's why we are there, and that's also why our scientists are there in this council participating, because the Arctic Council in its core is not necessarily something like the EU or so. It's much more, the focus is really on science. That's also why I'm glad to be here, because there are scientists around me, you know, so.
Yeah,
so they can enlighten us on what to do.
So let's talk about what to do there. Much of your work as the director of the Inclusive Green Growth Department concerns climate change.
And as we know, the Arctic mean temperature rises in the Arctic 3 times as fast as the global average. Last year, the world's largest iceberg, the megaberg, the size of Luxembourg, melted last year.
Yeah.
Since the 1980s, the polar ice has diminished from the size of like India.
Yeah.
What would you say is the largest loss to the communities in the Arctic and the biodiversity in the Arctic?
Yeah, it's phenomenal what's happening there. And there's also these record temperatures like 38 degrees. Mm. But what people oftentimes oversee is that in the Arctic region, there's millions of people living there, and they're dependent for their livelihood, for the ecosystem. They're dependent on the ecosystem as such. And of course, it also has a huge impact on, for example, the breeding grounds for birds, but also really the livelihood for people. We oftentimes have meetings with indigenous people, and they also bring very strong to the fore what it does to the reindeers and how they are. So it has an impact.
So
yeah.
What's
and
your
it's and, it, and our and I think what is really the problem is that it's overlooked. Because in a way, nobody owns the North Pole. There is, of course, the law of the sea. But when things are not owned by people, there might also be a tendency to overuse it. And that's why we are there.
Okay, so how does it kind of fit into a global ecosystem, the Arctic? What's the effect?
The effect is that some people try to explain it to me, because I'm a simple economist, like you guys, I guess, so because of PPE. No, but of course, it works a little bit like an air conditioning, the poles. And the faster they melt, the less impact they have on the climate and the cooling off of the Earth. So that is the main impact.
And how could that impact us here in Amsterdam one day?
It's a little bit below sea level here, okay. So that's messy. so that's definitely no, because that is really why it's also with director. That's also why it's one of my responsibilities, because I'm in charge of climate change policy within the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And then they thought, okay, where what is the most logic link to the Arctic? Is it Norway or is it Sweden or Russia? Then they said, no, let's link it to climate change. Let's link it to climate change, to biodiversity, because those are things that I'm responsible for.
So would you say that we've reached a point then where it's irreversible, climate change?
No. It's not irreversible yet, but we have to be faster. That was one of the fascinating things in Glasgow. Glasgow was my first trip, because I started in this job in September. We couldn't travel anywhere, so I haven't been to the Arctic, actually. I have to make I have to tell you that. But since September, I'm doing this job, but I've been to Glasgow. And of course, there are now commitments to, and if we all would follow up on those commitments, that's a big thing, then the temperature rise would be limited to 2.2, 2.3 degrees. But it is still too high, because we would rather be safe and we want to go for 1.5 degrees.
Right.
But to attain that goal, it literally would mean that we cannot have more fossil energy extraction than we already have.
But what's the difference between a 1.5 degrees and a 2 degrees?
It's been very well documented in the IPCC report, but it basically has a huge impact on the potential sea level rise, and that of course has a big impact on the Netherlands.
And so you've spoken of how you went to Glasgow, and also you have attended the Arctic Circle conference. What would you say are the current international cooperation strategies in place to save the Arctic?
I would say the main is really what we're trying to achieve in the context of the UN climate negotiations. And it is important that 80% of the countries that make 80% of the world economy have committed themselves to a net zero somewhere in 2050, 60 or 70. So that at least is important. So to save the Arctic, the North and the South Pole, I think the climate change policy is the most important. But there, of course, there are also other things, because as you may understand, there's of course a lot of raw materials and natural resources. So Russia has all kinds of plans to start exploring that as well. So what I think is really important, and it's always a horrible comparison because it's not that smooth, but the leapfrogging that happened in Africa, where people never had fixed telephone lines but immediately started calling with mobile phones, mm-hmm. You would really like to happen something like that in Africa, that people would not no longer need to use fossil energy, but they could really leapfrog towards solar energy, wind energy, other forms of more sustainable energy.
So in what capacity was the Arctic discussed at the COP26, for instance?
The COP doesn't necessarily discuss Africa or the Arctic, but it discusses biodiversity of or ecology or ecosystems. Mm-hmm. But of course, in the preparation of the COP, yeah. there's definitely this awareness amongst like-minded. What are we going to do here? And that's also what we try to bring to the fore in our strategy, Beslagen ten IJs, that you need to cooperate, because this is really the most important thing that we can do. And this summer, unfortunately, my colleague Hanna, who's sitting there on the first row, told me that all the tickets are already sold out, but there will be a climate change policy expedition to the Arctic in July. Unfortunately, I learned too late about it, otherwise I would have gone. You know, but Hanna will go, so she will report about it.
And did you find that the climate change in the Arctic was differently discussed at the COP26 and at the Arctic Circle Conference? Was there a different sense of urgency at the two conferences?
I think the one of the easiest way to make clear that there is climate change is by showing what's going on the Arctic. Mm-hmm. And as you said, the temperature rise goes 2 to 3 times or three times as fast. So the Arctic is a bit like the canary in the coal mine. So girls and guys, wake up. This is important.
Right. And so we can kind of hear the canary, but what actual actions are being taken place to address climate change in the Arctic right now?
One of the things that we're advocating is that there will be a moratorium on any fossil fuel exploration. So that is one of the things that we're advocating. But by the way, we're also doing that in a broader field, mm-hmm. Because that is one of the outcomes of Glasgow, is that we have said that 34 countries are committed to that we are no longer going to support as governments fossil fuel extraction in other countries. And of course, you immediately also get a backlash because companies like Van Oort and Boskalis are complaining because they had lucrative prospects in countries like Mexico or Mozambique or Tanzania. But that's how it is. I already said we should actually really stop with extracting fossil energy. So we're up against a lot of vested industrial interests.
And are you confident that these current strategies will save the 5 million Arctic residents?
I hope so. People in the Netherlands pay me taxes to be optimistic and to always try to make sure that we have the right kind of outcome. But so I have to be optimistic. But we have to work on it. Am I completely optimistic? I don't know. But on the other hand, technology is helping us a lot, and I'm also slightly optimistic that with this program that the EU now has, Fit for 55, we're really working hard to decrease greenhouse gas emissions by 55%, that also gives us, how do you say that, sort of the passport into the international world, that you can do it and that you can back up your lofty goals with actions. But it's a lot. And of course, geopolitics are interesting because there's now people, of course, with the gas prices and tensions with Russia, there's now people trying to sell it as if this is because of the... Is everything going well with your...
Yeah, a little fuzzy.
Yeah, can I help you?
I'll see.
No, but what you see is that there's a lot going on with people now almost blaming the energy transition that we want because of the energy transition that we want. No, it's just the gas crisis, and it has something to do with supply and demand.
So what next steps will be taken, do you think?
What is very important, because... It may be a bit weird, but if you want to save the Arctic, then you have to cooperate with the whole world. Yeah. And that's what we're seeking. So there will be climate conferences in Sharm el-Sheikh and Abu Dhabi next year. And they're very much focused also on adaptation and what needs to be done to in order to accommodate climate change, right. Which sounds in a way weird, but we need that kind of discussions because a lot of countries are already confronted with the impact of climate change.
But what could these policies look like?
For example, one of the goals is that poorer countries, that they have investment funding for climate finance to tackle the impact that it has. For example, that's a fund of $100 billion, And we've been promising this as the rich world, but we apart from the EU, other countries are not living up to that promise. So that is one of the things that we as the Netherlands, but also the EU, are pushing other countries to do, because if you want to agree on climate change, you have to do it with the hundreds of countries that we have.
So another thing which the Dutch polar strategy kind of discusses is not only stopping climate change, but also taking advantage of new economic opportunities. So I'm wondering, what are those new economic opportunities?
Well, mining, mining, oil extraction, no. What we have also said, and it's in capitals, it should be sustainable,
okay.
and it should not have a lasting impact. But on the other hand, we know that there are 5 million people living there, and if at some point there will be a free passage, then it will have an impact, or it will impact Rotterdam. So
yeah.
So we're looking at that. But I would really like to stress that we, at the moment, it's still we're keeping an eye on it, but we're not, as a government, promoting economic activities. Because a while ago, I got also this question. It was very timely,
yeah,
from a journalist, and he said, "What have your embassies been doing to promote the Dutch business interest in the Arctic?" So I went to all my colleagues, and they basically said, "Nothing yet." So we keep an eye on it, but we're not bringing groups of Dutch companies into the Arctic proactively to start doing business there.
No, because the...
Because it's, to be honest, it's we have our economic interest, so you always keep an eye on your economic interest, but our main interest is the ecosystems, is the preservation of what's out there, and is climate change.
Because the polar strategy does have a section focused on the economic interest.
Yeah.
So would the Netherlands, let's say, potentially benefit from resource extraction in the Arctic?
Yes. One of the things that I have done is that I have had all kinds of meetings with the banking sectors, the insurance sector, so all the stakeholders in the financial sector, to say, guys, we rather don't have you do this anymore. That sounds very voluntary or permissive, but we're having these discussions with the financial sector,
yeah,
with other companies, to refrain themselves from those kind of activities, to go into the extraction, because we feel that that might have an impact. So it's sort of, that's sort of my diplomacy towards the Dutch companies.
So how come the Polish strategy does include using those economic opportunities if you're actively advocating against them?
We're not advocating against every activity. There are of course also, you're from Norway,
yeah,
so you know that.
I
you're
know.
So for example, one of my friends is the Norwegian ambassador, and whenever we talk about the polar strategy, it's of course he doesn't want his country to become depopulated in the north. So it's also important that there are activities, but the main reason why we keep an eye on the economic activities is to make sure that they are sustainable.
Mm.
And we're not going to tell Dutch companies what they can do or not can do, but we are going to tell them that it should be sustainable.
Because one of the biggest
the most dire ones are, of course, rare earths,
of course,
raw materials, yeah.
And one that is often discussed is this northern sea route, and of course, the Netherlands, being a trade nation, could benefit greatly from this new route, which would cut the Asia-Europe journey from, 7 weeks to 19 days,
yeah,
and ports like Rotterdam could obviously benefit.
Yeah, you no longer get stuck in the Suez.
Exactly.
The Suez, but you can, exactly.
And how would the Dutch plan to benefit from this route?
It's really as defensive as I talk now.
Mm-hmm.
We hope that it will never materialize, but we know from science that it might materialize,
mm-hmm,
and then we want to keep in mind what are the opportunities there and what will be the impact on the Netherlands being an important distribution hub in Europe. But we're not actively seeking it as a government, but we're following it, but we're not going out there and say to Dutch companies, "Hey guys, something very important going on. Let's go." What we are promoting are these expeditions on climate change, and what we are promoting is if you do business there, do it sustainable.
Okay, so let's talk about that and kind of cooperation. How would the Arctic Council balance their commitment to combating climate change with these new economic opportunities?
How they do that within internally.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it has also something to do with the mandate of the Arctic Council.
Okay.
The mandate of the Arctic Council is very much focused on science and the preservation,
mm-hmm,
of the Arctic. So in that sense, it is not an economic council. There is a working group that looks at the shipping routes, But its main focus is really science and the preservation of the Arctic. So the battle for the geopolitical interest is fought out more in bilateral terms.
Mm. Okay.
So and in that sense, I'm also quite happy that we can preserve the Arctic Council as a meeting where we try to speak objectively based on facts instead of on framing and fake news.
But is that effective for creating policy if it's completely kind of this own little bubble outside of geopolitics?
I wouldn't say it's its own little bubble, because it's about science. And I still think that the Enlightenment is what brought us here. So I think it is actually very strong, and you don't want it to get diluted by political reasons why certain science should not be done and others should be done. So I really want to keep it more scientific.
Right.
And of course, science has always a policy relevance. But I think that's really the value of it.
Okay.
Because as soon as you bring in all kinds of political arguments, it may lose some of its scientific relevance as well.
Mm-hmm. And let's bring it back to the people who actually live there. How would these opportunities benefit the residents of the Arctic?
I think that our anchor woman here is very well first to say something about that. No, but that's a difficult one. That's really a difficult one. We find it very difficult because people do traditional things, but there are also quite a few who are leaving their groups.
Right.
And the surroundings are changing, so it's a very difficult one. And it's of course we are glad that we have the participatory partners of the indigenous people who come to the fore and who also explain how, for example, you can, with an eye on biodiversity or ecosystem, can still do fishing or hunting or those kind of things. So those are important considerations.
Mm.
That we still allow for those activities to take place. But large-scale whaling is not part of that.
So I'm really trying to understand the irony a little bit, because as much as I understand, the current Polish strategy just talks of safeguarding these economic opportunities in a sustainable way. However, your previous Polish strategy didn't include these economic opportunities at all. Do you not think that as the director of the Inclusive Green Growth Department, you cannot champion sustainability and fighting climate change, yet at the same time putting a blind eye to the fact that these countries in the Arctic Council are gathering a lot of wealth from the melting polar ice?
Yeah. And that's why I'm there, to have that conversation with them, because most people would let's, because it's easier to talk about Norway than Russia. I don't know why, but somehow it's easier to talk about Norway than Russia.
I do not agree with the government
the discussions, of course, that we have with those countries is indeed how do you balance that? Because on the one hand you do this in climate on your climate change policy, on the other hand you're doing that, and that's what I said. Also, the Netherlands has really to improve. We also have to improve our policy. So whatever you think about, whatever you voted for in your own country or in the Netherlands, I'm happy that at least this government has a focus on climate change. Because what is your legitimacy if you don't keep your own house in order? So I agree with you, but that's exactly the kind of conversation that we're having. But not necessarily in the Arctic Council, but in the context of the COP or bilaterally.
Yeah, because to me it kind of seems, using Greta Thunberg's metaphor, as if our global house is on fire, instead of doing something about it in the Arctic, we're just grilling marshmallows and using the opportunities this burning house provides. So kind of having these extended economic opportunities, having these new trade routes for the Netherlands, and it doesn't seem as if the Netherlands putting a stop to it, but rather just engaging with it.
As I said, we are not promoting any economic activities, and the reason why we follow it is that we're living in a free country, so we know we don't have our companies on a leash, but we want to engage them in a dialogue, and if necessary, we'll come up with laws, or we change our policies like we did in November, no longer subsidies for any fossil fuel projects abroad, so also not in the Arctic. So that's what we're doing. And I definitely see also the dichotomy, or you can say hypocrisy, is in many policies. But that's why it is so important. If we really truly want net zero paths as of 2050. We're going to do revolutionary things. Mm-hmm. And we need to do revolutionary, we really have to change drastically our societies. And as I said, there are a lot of vested interests that give a pushback, and it also distort what's going on. The economics for renewables is there. But if you would now listen to a lot of politicians, they think that the government is crazy, and how could we no longer invest in gas extraction or making sure that we're importing more gas? No, that's not what we want. If what I understood, I had a meeting last week in with the European Commission representatives, is they say Europe imports about 190 billion cubic meters gas from Russia. If you want to be independent, then just do whatever we wrote in Fit for 55, because mm-hmm. that will save you out of the 190, 160 billion cubic meters of gas. If you, in addition, make sure that you contract green hydrogen, for example, from countries like Chile or Morocco or Namibia, then you have an additional 30 billion. So in a way, we can reduce our gas import into the gas usage by just following up on the plans that we have. But that requires massive changes.
Could you describe a couple of those massive changes that have to be made? Is it just stopping new gas extraction, or?
It's stopping the extraction of fossil, or at least stopping the exploration of new fossil fuel. And it's also about hydrogen, and it's about electrification. So that's basically what it is. But if you, but for example, we all know, if you look at the demographics of Africa, because another India and China in the next decades will join Africa, in the sense that the its population will grow by 1 billion, 1.5 billion, 2 billion people. Those people need massive economic growth to have a decent way of living. And I really hope that we are able to do that with sustainable energy.
And bringing it back a little bit.
So that's what we're supporting, for example, with smaller programs, because my budget is 730 million euros per year. So, and that's really focused on poorer countries, what we call official development aid, ODA countries.
And bringing back to kind of the power of, let's say, you as the director of the Inclusive Green Growth Department, would you hope that the Netherlands could restrain and regulate the Dutch companies more, and therefore the Dutch output into these economic opportunities in the Arctic?
I'm really glad that we're no longer giving subsidies for fossil fuel extractions, and I really hope that we will also do everything we can to promote sustainable energy in the Netherlands. I think it's crazy that we're still working with the combustion engine. It was a nice invention in more than 100 years ago, but it's crazy that we're still using that. So if you look at the details of Fit for 55 and getting there, it will require a lot of changes. But for example, one of the things that we're also doing is deforestation is a huge issue. So there's now a regulation of the EU, a law, to make sure that on our shelves in the EU there will no longer be products that were made in a way that led to deforestation. The regulation, the law, has an impact on 1/3 of the surface of the earth. 1/3 of the surface of the earth. So it's gigantic. But you can also expect many countries to be sour and angry that we're doing that. Because it's nice that all those rich cats in the European Union are fighting deforestation by not allowing those products anymore in the EU. But how are we going to help those countries also to change their production towards a more sustainable way of producing and consuming? So that's also part of this climate change policy discussion, and it's also part of how to defend the Arctic.
And what are those steps to help countries outside of the wealthy West achieve prosperity while being sustainable?
We invest heavily in things that have something to do with human dignity. So in water supply, sanitation, nutrition, clean cooking, green energy. Those are very important programs that we invest heavily in. And on top of that, also in sustainable energy in Africa. And we do that through multilateral organizations, like the Climate Investment Funds or the Global Environment Facility. But we also do it through our own embassies.
Mm-hmm. So we'll have one last section before we open up the questions to the audience. So essentially, this boils down to prioritizing economic opportunities or prioritizing climate change.
Yeah.
As the director of the Inclusive Green Growth Department, what's your strategy to make sure that economic opportunities don't reign over your mandate to promote sustainability and countering climate change?
First and foremost, to make sure that everything that we have committed to ourselves in the Netherlands, but also internationally, that we're going to live up on that. So to implement that, that is really the most important thing. And make people aware what the implementation gap is. That is an important thing that where Hannah and I and many others at the ministry are working on, but also actually in very good cooperation with economic affairs.
Okay, thank you. Is there anyone in the audience who has any questions to the ambassador?
And it can also be a little bit outside this subject if you want. You know, now that I'm here.
Of course. Yes, so we have a gentleman in the gray sweater.
Can I stand up? Or? Sorry, is that too loud?
No.
So in reading for this event, I was led to believe that under the Arctic, there is a huge reservoir of oil or natural energy. And I was thinking that if the ice caps are shrinking, does that mean that at some point it might actually be economically viable to harvest this resource? Would you like to comment on that?
No, I share your impressions and also a little bit your underlying fear. Yes, that is definitely the case, and that's also why we think that. That's why I think we really should take the window of opportunity to promote sustainable energy sources, so that the economics for sustainable energy are so much stronger, so that there is no need to actually extract that. But that brings you also in a very interesting discussion, because how are we going to engage Russia, for example, that has strong economic interest in the fossil energy, in a transition path towards a sustainable net zero economy? So yeah, no, we're not discussing what's going on now in the Ukraine, but also this is one of the questions that we ask ourselves. How can we engage them, and how can it also be for them economically profitable to get on a path like that, so that they let the oil in it. But yes, just as much as I mentioned the one to two billion people in Africa, there are a lot of fossil energy sources in Africa. But of course, the main interest of the Netherlands is that they keep them in the soil and not that they're not starting to extract them. Yeah, it's a good question.
Any other questions? In the gray sweater.
All right, yes, good afternoon. You mentioned that for now the Arctic Council, rather than being a scene for political fights, is quite based, the discussions there are quite based on objective facts and science. However, do you think that, especially after talking about different economic interests, do you think that this is a sustainable, or like this is going to be the case in the next few years? Or do you think the sphere of the Arctic Council itself and the dynamics will change because of the clashes of different political interests? Or will the Arctic Council keep this sort of, well science-based, atmosphere?
No, it's very good. I really hope that we can keep the politics out of the Arctic Council, and that we can keep it as a consensus-forming council where we look at science and not at political interest. But of course your question is justified, because there's a lot of tensions going on, and apart from what's going on in the Ukraine, the very fact that we are aiming for a transition towards sustainable energy sources away from fossil energy means that you're impacting people's economic interests, and that in itself already creates a new dynamic. The rise of China is very interesting. If you look at the Far East, what is called the Far East in Russia, I think that's one of the least populated parts of the world. I think there's only 7 or 8 million people living there, and then you really have a big chunk of Russia, whereas you have that nice southern neighbor which has 1.3 billion people, so it's over 1 billion people. So there's a lot going on there. Russia as a Pacific nation, China, the rise of China, but on the other hand, Also the IPCC and how we conduct our climate change investigations are also done in a more or less unpolitical dialogue. So let's keep our fingers crossed that we can do that here as well. Thanks.
Okay, we can take one last question from the second row, white sweater.
Hi, thank you. So you keep on kind of saying the Arctic Council, it's a purely scientific council, and we do not really kind of integrate politics in that discussion. But in the meantime, this is also one of the only political places No. where indigenous people do get a say. So I wonder, don't you think that acting like it's a purely scientific council kind of takes away the political power that these people might need to have in order to save their own countries and their own land?
Yeah. Yeah, of course, that is also a way to approach it. I think by focusing on the Arctic and a limited scope of economic interest, namely the people who live there and who are from there, the local and indigenous, that you then at least you limit it. You have a very specific limited demarcation. If you would broaden it to the rest of Russia, to the rest of Norway, to the rest of Canada, the United States, then it becomes less focused, and the chances that their interest will be diluted become larger. So I think that by having a very limited scope on the interest, the economic interest of the indigenous, sort of avoids from getting even more weak towards whatever interests are already out there, and that they will be sort of dwarfed by geopolitical or more egoistic interests from outside the region that they live in.
So yes, we will take some questions at the end as well. Thank you for all your questions so far. So a lot of these issues we've discussed and the issues from the audience can be solved by international cooperation. However, that's a bit hard with the current Arctic tensions sometimes. So Russia, Denmark, and Canada are, for instance, laying claim to Arctic waters. Could you perhaps give some light on this dispute between them?
Yeah, for us, the law of the sea is the most important legal framework in which we want to have these discussions. But I cannot deny you put the finger on the spot, right spot. That is there, and I so. That's definitely true, but we hope that there is a dispute resolve mechanism.
So keeping the Dutch interests in mind, what would be the ideal resolution of this international legal dispute?
For us, it's the most important thing. I mean, I don't want to sound holier than whatever, but for us, the most ideal solution would be that it would be as sustainable as possible, really as sustainable as possible, with as little impact as possible, with only, yeah, that's our focus.
What does that mean?
That whatever they're doing there is very limited, yeah, and not large scale.
Okay, because for instance,
so
you
or sustainable, or that you look at aquifers and how it renews itself, etc.
Because, for instance, in this international legal dispute, you have countries such as Russia, which are extending their international legal waters by building man-made structures,
yes,
putting flags on the bottom of the Arctic Sea.
Yes.
How do you, what do you think of these sort of actions?
Yeah. Russia does that. We've seen flags everywhere. It's very destabilizing, and it's not helpful. The only thing that I can say is that we promote in also in the context mm-hmm. of NATO to be restrained, to be careful about our rhetorics, and to really stay out of it. Stay
yeah.
out of it, and don't mess up things.
Because what would happen if you would?
We don't want to create more tension. We don't want this to become a sort of a military thing, because it is there and mm-hmm. and actually our strategy would be, as I said earlier, that that in a way we find alternative ways for whatever is out there in the Arctic. So don't use their fossil energy sources, for example.
So it is already becoming a military thing, though, right? So NATO doubled their troops in the Arctic since 2015. Russia has moved 81% of their nuclear arsenal into the Arctic Circle, apparently. Tensions between Russia and the West are at an all-time high. Should we expect a proxy war in the Arctic?
No. No.
Okay.
No, but what happens, of course, is that we know that between 2030 and 50, there will be this passageway. Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden, Russia has an exposed border. And if you look at the Arctic coastline, it's over 50% is Russia's. So that Russia also thinks about, what are we going to do with that exposed border? Makes sense. All countries think about borders. There's no military threats at the moment.
And that's the only cause of remilitarizing?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know. Every country has a legitimate concern how to defend its borders and to think about that.
Yeah.
And as I said, I mean, Russia has interesting phenomena. Depopulation in the Far East, mm-hmm. where only 7 to 8 million people live, facing a neighbor that has hundreds of millions in the same area. So that's interesting. I mean, and the Russians think about that, how they are going to cope with that. Makes sense to a certain extent.
So we don't need to be concerned from a geopolitical standpoint, but shouldn't we be concerned as this might jeopardize our sustainability work, right? So how much can actually be accomplished through dialogue if there are kind of security concerns, if you're poking your neighbor?
Why would that be a contradiction? Why would that be a contradiction?
Don't you think the Arctic Council as a center of dialogue and a mm-hmm. center of cooperation yep. be jeopardized if there's a level of security concern?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know.
But it hasn't affected the Arctic Council work or sustainability work in the Arctic.
Not at the moment. No, not at the moment. No, so that's why I'm hesitant to answer your question. Yeah.
So okay. Russia moving 81% of its nuclear arsenal into the Arctic is in no way worrying the other Arctic nations.
There are NATO members in that region. It's Denmark, Norway, Iceland, UK, Canada, the US. There's a grouping in NATO, the Northeast, and we're always prepared.
Right. So the Arctic Council only concerns science and
yes.
sustainability.
Yes.
But do you think that's
why I like it so much.
Yeah, I see. But do you think it should also expand its premise to include some mandate for peaceful security as well?
No, I think that whatever the science tells us that is relevant to the Arctic has a compelling message in itself. If whatever we need to resolve our military disputes or our potential conflicts, for that we have other organizations like the UN Security Council. There's a dialogue between NATO and Russia, so we should really use those kind of meetings. So there's also a dialogue with China,
mm-hmm.
so let's really focus on that.
Right.
Yeah.
And you really don't think that tension will affect sustainability work?
As I said, what is going on now? I mean, the energy prices are rising in Europe. So there are people who want us to believe that the transition towards sustainable energy is not a great idea. So of course, when there are tensions, it you really have to be careful that you don't lose your message, and that you don't lose focus, and that you don't create possibilities for fake news or distorted facts. So. Yeah, I really think that it's interesting what's going on now, that the energy prices are rising. I mean, and so we really have to have a focused answer that, no, we have to draw the right conclusions. And it's also backed up by, for example, the International Energy Agency. They say, mm-hmm. yes, of course the energy prices are rising now because of tension. But the answer is to go after sustainable, and the answer is not to go after oil and gas.
Okay.
But there is a tangible tension. There is an Arctic
like there is
military
now.
Tension. In
but
the
like there is already, there is a tension now that has an impact on our climate change policies and on our sustainability policies. So I'm not denying that tensions are not helpful, but at the same time I'm saying that the work in the Arctic Council per se, as such, as an organization, has been rather untouched by it. And that's what I like, that's how I like to keep it. But that we have, that there are military tensions at the moment mm-hmm. is very clear, and that it has an impact on our, and that it might have an impact on our the effectiveness of our climate change policy is also clear, and that's also why we're working so hard to make a case why you should, in spite of higher fossil energy prices, you should still move into sustainable energy and go for the sustainable solutions.
And what would you say is the defining cause of this remilitarization?
What is the defining cause of the conflict that we have in the Ukraine? I don't know. Who has an answer to that? No, there are so many. We are trying to. That's why we have a dialogue with Russia. Mm-hmm. We are trying to understand what's going on now at the moment.
Right. And what kind of steps are you taking, perhaps, to continue your sustainability work, even if there is some sort of contention?
Oh, we're definitely continuing. We're actually going full speed ahead, and that's also why our Minister for Climate and Energy and my Minister for Foreign Trade and Development Cooperation are also working on an international climate strategy for the whole Dutch government. So we get all the agencies and all the ministries involved in really having an international climate strategy, because we think it's important as a complement to what we're doing in the Netherlands and as a complement to what we're doing abroad. To also make sure that we are active in other countries and that we also do not lose focus.
So what else can we expect from this Arctic strategy, or the global strategy there for climate change?
I hope that we will, for example, start some green deals with a couple of strategic countries. That we're really starting to focus on how can we promote our innovation, our trade and investment interest in a green framework. We're already doing that, but we can do more focus on. We can really have more focus on that. Okay. For example, the ambassador and his team in India, they're really sort of looking at what can we do to help India to attain its goal to become zero neutral.
But
for example, in the International Solar Alliance.
But how do these discussions, for instance, progress with Russia, who will be expanding their oil business and oil trade with the new Northern Sea Route, with the new pipelines? Wouldn't that be the most dominant player you'd want to have more green deals with?
We're definitely also interested in having this dialogue with Russia, and also to sort of see and understand where Russia's economic interests are in going on this sustainable path.
Right.
And what do you think they have sustainable aspirations as well?
Well, they signed up to a pledge. Mm-hmm. So they probably understand that economics has a certain objectivity because it dictates prices in world markets. So they probably understand that there is also benefit there. Yeah.
And do you
and let's not forget also with the permafrost and the methane and everything that extracts
and
from
the
that,
giant wildfires in Siberia.
They're impacted by climate change heavily.
Do you know of any steps they're actually taking at the moment to combat climate change?
They seem modest compared to what is needed. Yeah.
Because they currently are chairing the Arctic Council, Russia.
Yeah.
In what way do you see them leading the Arctic Council and their chairmanship?
They're very active, but as I said, very much focused on what we'd like to do there as well, on the scientific part of it.
So you don't see them leveraging their position in the Arctic Council in the economic or military sphere?
No, not at the moment. No. Okay. No.
And how confident can we feel in that research that's being done? I mean, I'm sure it's scientifically accurate, but will it provide a pathway to preventing massive climate change in the Arctic? Or is it just telling us what's happening and...
It's for example, descriptive yeah. when it comes to migratory patterns of birds. I will promise you that I will send you the report of our of our climate change expedition that goes in July, because they're really focusing on what needs to be done, and what are the patterns, and why is it sort of the canary in the coal mine, and how come that climate change goes twice as the temperature rise goes twice as fast as anywhere else, and what impact that might have on the Netherlands. Anna, do you have something to add to that?
Mm-hmm. Because what the Arctic Council tries to do delivering this knowledge. And that really legitimizes our asks also then. Hey, we got guys, we have these facts. Mm-hmm. Now let's act upon this.
Right. So a very vulnerable biodiversity place in the Netherlands is the Wadden Sea. You have a lot of nesting birds there.
Yep.
Are you confident that action will be taken to save the nesting birds in somewhere like that?
You mean like in Waddenzee?
Yeah. You know, what needs to be done and will it be done?
It's heavily impacted by sea level rise.
Yeah.
So that's something that we're super concerned about.
Okay.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, the Waddenzee is one of the most beautiful wetlands and most valuable wetlands that we have in Europe, and it's heavily impacted by sea level rise. So we're very concerned about that.
But
it's a very nice example because we started gas extraction in the Waddenzee not even that long ago. You know, so we have to live up to
that balance. And
yeah.
And is the action being taken to live up to your sustainability goals there?
Exactly. So that's why I like to have these dialogues, because then you tell me that what we need to do, and it's good. You know,
right.
But it's really
Excellent.
Good to have these discussions in the open, because, as I said, sometimes you have to live up to what you promise.
And on that note, we would love to ask, what is the one goal you'd want to achieve by the end of your time as the Arctic Ambassador and the Director of the Inclusive Green Growth Department?
My biggest worry is that now, as I said, so many the countries that add up to 80% of the world's GDP, that they have all made this pledge on a net zero path. But it's a pledge. It's a pledge. So I really hope that in 3.5 years, when I move on to another exciting job, that let's say that there is really implementation capacity behind that, because that is my biggest worry. And as a private citizen, I also hope that by then there is still a president in the United States who supports a progressive and strong climate change policy, because we would not have been able to achieve as much as we did in Glasgow if it wasn't also for the United States being part of it, being one of the big emitters of greenhouse gases. So that's what I hope.
Well, thank you so much. We will open now for some more questions from the audience. We can take a question from the back, lady in the red.
On the one hand, are there large oil fields and maybe also gas fields underneath of the Arctic Ocean, especially above the Arctic coast of Russia, that might become a pressing social need for economic need for Russia? But if not, or if they, is there a new initiative towards nuclear energy, the development of modern nuclear reactors based on thorium, of which the time span of radioactive decay is much shorter than with plutonium and uranium? And is there a risk that sparsely habitated areas like the Arctic may be, will be concerned places considered places useful to place these reactors, so they can even be drifting, they can be made quite small, they can make some kind of drifting islands of thorium reactors, they are already developing these things. Is that a risk in the Arctic?
I very much like your question, because you're also aware of probably that the Dutch government has decided that nuclear is again a possibility for our energy mix. And also within the EU, are working out a taxonomy to decide whether it's a green investment or not. And some forms of natural gas and nuclear are sort of orange in between categories. I personally think that you have to be super, super, super careful with building nuclear power plants. You have to be super careful, and you really have to understand what the dynamics are, and I would not advocate for any experiments. But I very well understand where your question is coming from, and it's one of the things that we're also thinking about. So thank you very much for your question, but I think we have to be very careful, and definitely not start applying it in a situation where you don't have absolute stability and also knowledge what can happen. Yeah, thank you.
We have a question from a gentleman in the green.
Thank you. I was watching this, and I counted the amount of times that you were struggling giving an answer when Russia came up. And I was on 9 right now. And I was just wondering, I mean, I imagine that it must be difficult as an ambassador to talk about the subject. So I would like to ask my question a little bit broader. I mean, as an ambassador, is that a fun side or a frustrational side to your job that you have to avoid these topics all the time?
It's definitely a fun side. I was ambassador to Hungary, for example, till this summer. And of course, there's been some discussions going on between Prime Minister Rutte and Prime Minister Orban. And I was also part of that conversation. But I was never the one who openly went out to criticize the Hungarian government. But I would bring our narrative to the fore when I would meet with them. So as an ambassador, you're not necessarily always the one, or let's say you're likely not always the one who criticizes a country openly, but you're useful when you meet bilaterally behind closed doors. Having said that, for example, when Hungary came up with the in my eyes, but also the Dutch government's eyes, rather strange LGBTQI law, I was happy to walk in the forefront of the gay pride march. So you pick your moments, and there's always subtle ways to say it. But so why I'm sometimes a little bit hesitant is that I can say so much more, and you're a scientist, you're academics. So in a way, sometimes I want to say more, but I also know that is not necessarily always my role. Okay. But it is my role when I meet with them in person. Okay. But the members of parliament speak out, or the ministers speak out. And we keep a lower profile.
So if you're saying that they were in Russia, they are modest with their efforts to be more green, then we can interpret that as that they're not doing enough. That's more or less what you're saying, right?
But as I said, we also need to pick up our pace, because to live up to minus 49%, we in the Netherlands also should do a few more things. So.
Thank you for your question. Is there any other questions?
In that case, I think thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador, for coming to Room for Discussion. Thank you to our brilliant audience for your wonderful questions. Tomorrow we will have another interview with the CEO of Triodos Bank, so please be here.
Okay. It was a pleasure to be outside and
Excellent. To
meet with people in person.
Yeah,
so thank you so much for listening to us, and please also know to contact us, because we as a ministry, we may not speak openly always, but we're very happy to exchange information that we have with you. So don't hesitate to contact us. Thank you. Thanks a lot.